based on two products, coal and steel, very important, but two, has developed into a process of integration, which is now not anything like a state, not even like a federation, but certainly something further integrated than a normal international organization.
I can understand France trying to put clamps on Germany, but why would Germany go along with this idea of the French? What is the French motivation, I understand. What is the German motivation to accept this type of a clamp?
That's difficult to say because very easily you might go into psychoanalysis of country psychoanalysis. But I think that Germany had at least two good reasons, probably more than two, but two good reasons to be interested in this deal. One is that in order to regain its full independence, Germany had to show a new will to live in peace with the neighbors. Germany was basically the responsible for the two last wars. Germany had started both last wars. And somehow they needed to demonstrate that that was not going to happen again and that they were willing to begin to live under new terms. Basically, the new terms is the difference between a zero-sum game or a cooperative game. What was being proposed at that time is saying we have to organize things in Europe in a way in which this is not you win or I win and you lose, but it's a game in which we cooperate together and everybody wins. And Germany somehow had to show that they had the will to do that. That was one reason. The other reason is that for the nascent German industry that was recuperated and being rehabilitated after the war, the possibility to have a market in which the very big market of France would be open to the industrial production was also quite tempting. And in fact, if you look at the economic development of the European Union, before the European Community, this idea in which Germany basically is the one that has profited more from an enlarged market is there, while at the same time, probably France has, to a certain extent, draw more profit in geostrategic terms and has re-enhanced its role in Europe and in the world politically, while Germany was doing it economically. And at the end of the day, I think it was a game that was interesting for the two countries.
But did German guilt also play a part for the tragic criminality of what had been done by Germany in the lead up to World War II?
I was trying to put it more mildly, but yes, I think.
Yeah, please, we are among friends.
I think obviously that was a factor. That was a factor in the sense that Germany had a deep sentiment of guilt, naturally, after what had happened. And somehow, this was a way of redemption, if you want to put it that way.
And has Germany achieved that redemption?
That's a difficult question. I wouldn't dare to give a very clear-cut answer. I think that to a large extent, yes, but probably not completely.
Okay, let's go into another aspect. The European Union is an expansionist entity. You start with six, and then you become nine, then you become 10, then you become 12, then you become 15, then you become 25, then you become 28. I think I would be scared of you because I have no idea what is the ultimate extent of your ambition. What are you trying to do? Are you trying to take over the world with a new European Holy Roman Empire over the whole world? Are you trying to displace the United Nations? How far does Europe go? You've already got NATO, which is one of your military arms, in Afghanistan. How is Afghanistan in the North Atlantic? And what is your definition of Europe? Can Pakistan become a member of the European Union, for example?
Who knows? Things as they are. But there is one thing that we have to say. We are, that's a fact, expansionists, but we are peacefully expansionists.
There is no such thing as peaceful expansion.
Well, this is an expansion which is actually new members coming in more than we expanding. It's the process is the other one around. And it's very curious because it's true that this is a process that has for many years, the six founding members were six, and then progressively, in a progressive acceleration, we enlarge up to 27. There is a fundamental idea behind this, is that the European Union, the European Community, the Treaty of Rome in 1958, at the time where the Cold War was extremely present, was willingly and very specifically made to embrace the whole Europe. That was the ultimate goal, is that that process that was being created would one day be able to expand and embrace the whole Europe. So this idea that any European country has a right to become member of the EU is somehow there, is not something that can be translated into a specific right that you can go to a court and claim, but it's basically there. On the other hand, expansion has created not a few problems to the EU in terms of how we work, our own management, the decision-making process, etc. And this has raised also the question mark, should we continue expanding? Should we continue to expand to the whole of Europe? And if that's the case, where are the borders of Europe? But to begin with, where are the borders of the European Union? And this is something which is not written anywhere. There are not fixed borders. And it's a process in which each case is considered on its own merits. But the reality is that for the last 10 years, we have been saying that we had to enlarge and deepen the EU, meaning we had to enlarge physically and at the same time deepen our level of integration, become more and more integrated, giving more and more sovereignty to the EU from the member states. The reality is that this has been somehow unbalanced, and now enlargement has clearly gone much further than the deepening in the process of integration. So somehow there is there a rebalance that is pending. A way, at least partially, to do this was the Lisbon Treaty. First the Constitutional Treaty, then the Lisbon Treaty, that was supposed to reform in depth the EU to make it more suitable to work with 27 members. Unfortunately, for the time being, one member state in a referendum has rejected the ratification of the treaty. We don't know now what is going to be the next step. Probably at some point, this member state will look again to the question. But for the time being, we are in a waiting mode. But clearly, sooner or later, if we have to maintain our level of integration, we need a reform. We need to become more efficient. We need to become more democratic in terms of institutions, etc.
Yes, but when you speak of borders, that's the vital question. What are the borders of Europe? When we learned geography, we were told that Europe was from the Atlantic to the Urals. So is Russia a member of Europe?
I think that Russia obviously is a member of Europe, but whether it would be a member of the European Union, that's a different thing.
Then you are discriminatory against Russia.
Well, for the time being, not, because they are not interested in becoming members of the EU. That is quite clear. I mean, Russia has never, ever shown any interest in that. And clearly, the possibility, if you look at it very theoretically, of Russia becoming a member, it would be a problem, because apart from other differences, simply the size would be completely impossible